The Bog by Struggle. Upstate New York is idyllic in October, I thought. A setting sun lit off the multiple hues of the trees that blanketed the sides of Route 11. If my mind wasn't firmly occupied with the near future, I'm sure I'd have appreciated the scenery and drive more.
Arriving at your destination on the left.
My phone chimed. I pulled my BMW over to the shoulder, scanning my surroundings for anything of note. I found a single easily overlooked gravel road that absconded into the forest canopy beyond, and trusting that this was the right place, took it. When I learned there was a social taking place for all the well-to-dos and power players in my zip code, well, I hadn't rested until I'd found where. I'd need support to climb the rung and break into politics, and if what little I'd pieced together was true, this would be the right place to make those connections. It took 5 minutes of driving up the narrow path for it to widen out onto a flat patch of gravel. The other vehicles here told me this is where I was meant to park, and the makes and models of the cars reaffirmed that this was the right place. I pulled into a tight space between a Bugatti and an Aston Martin, checked my hair in the mirror, and applied a fresh coat of red lipstick. My nerves flared, and I cursed myself for wearing a bright red, low-cut dress. I wanted to draw attention, but I also worried that I'd make the wrong impression on the other women here. A few calming breaths muted the rising panic. I composed myself, got out, and locked the door. Thinking ahead, I decided to walk barefoot across the gravel lot. Uncomfortable as it was, the last thing I wanted was a broken heel or sprained ankle. A single dirt path, lit by torches on either side, meandered into the forest ahead, a helpful guide as dusk gave way to the shadows of Half Moon Night. I walked along the path for what felt like ages, the dancing of the torches the only thing to keep me company. I tried to ignore the snapping of branches and the other unfamiliar noises of the forest, and my attempts to pay no heed to the odd noises flagged when it sounded like a full tree and all its roots were pulled from the earth. I whipped in the direction of the noise. I couldn't see anything beyond the soft glow of the torches, though. And for a second it seemed like I might have imagined it. That was till I heard felling trees and the bodily slams that accompany the end of their journey to the earth. Any sense of decorum was lost as I sprinted up the path. As scared as I was, I still clung to the heels of my offhand and did what I could with my dress in the other. The noise followed, and I chanced to look back to find that the torches would flicker out a few seconds after I passed them. Time slowed when my foot caught root, tripping me and causing me to fall, and I landed hard on my right arm and skidded just a bit in the unpacked earth. I was sure whatever was out there would have me. Instead, I heard laughter. It was then I realized I'd screamed. I looked up to find myself in a clearing surrounded by at least 100 others. My embarrassment at my entrance is one thing, but the attire or lack thereof on some of the other guests became a new source of embarrassment. My eyes had a hard time wandering as their shapes drew closer. Men and women alike wore something akin to masquerade masks. At least, that's the closest description to them that I could find in my shocked and addled state. They weren't quite the fancy things of balls, but their animalistic and tribal styles were certainly well-crafted and varied. Some even looked like real animal skulls. Some men wore something like a sarong, the rest of their exposed skin covered in swirls and strange smatterings of body paint. I noticed that some of the men opted for only the paint. Few of the women seemed to be that bold, but a higher degree than normal of exposed flesh seemed to be the standard here. "You all right? That was a nasty spill," one of the men in a bear mask said.
"Yeah. Just got spooked is all. There's something in the woods," I replied.
"Never mind that. Let me help you up."
I was glad that the man offering me a hand was at least half-clothed. I got my first good look at the clearing once I was on my feet. Everywhere I looked were things that reminded me of idolatry. Carved statues, stretched pelts over wooden frames, bundles of sticks painstakingly bent and bound to look like characters of people. And at the center, next to a giant bonfire, was some horribly grotesque monstrosity made of bleached bones.
"What is all this?" I asked, panic and instant regret creeping into my voice as I instinctively backed a step towards the path I'd just been dying to exit.
"Whoa, calm down. I know how this looks," the man that helped me up said. He was quick to take off his mask.
"Name's Richard Stanford. You might have heard of me."
I have. Your father owns Trinity Biomedical Upstate," I said.
"That's right. It looks like you have no idea what's going on here, though, Miss..."
"Adrian, and not in the slightest," I said, debating on whether I could outrun him and whatever was on the wooded path.
Unfortunate. Newcomers are supposed to get an orientation and be chaperoned to their first bog. Seems like you slipped through the cracks. How's that?"
I'm an attorney. I overheard one of the senior partners at my firm talking about how he wasn't going to make the social this year."
"So his partner told you about it? Who is he?"
"Ambrose Alserschwitz. He didn't so much tell me, as I kind of took the initiative to snag the location from his planner that he leaves at the office," Adrian said.
"A fucking party crasher,"
one of the women in the back of the crowd hissed.
"Well, I don't suppose I approve of your methods," said an old man wearing a crow mask that the crowd parted for. "But I'll give you credit for ambition and resourcefulness. You found the bog, and what is revealed cannot be hidden."
What is revealed cannot be hidden.
those gathered repeated.
"What's that mean?" I asked.
"That you may stay, if you wish," the old man said.
Richard nodded in response before turning to the gathering crowd.
"Give us some space, would you? It's our first bog. I'll orientate her."
Even behind the mass, I could tell some were biting back remarks and seething looks. A few departed reluctantly, and others muttered in disappointment that Richard would be the one to break me in, which only sent a new wave of shivers down my spine and added to the sense of regret at coming here.
"What is all this?" I asked. Half of Richard's face scrunched like he'd just heard an impossible question to answer, and he rubbed the back of his neck.
"It's easier to experience the bog than it is to explain it."
"Try, please," I said.
"Okay, well, think like Burning Man, but a bit more than that, as you can see from our get-ups," Richard said.
"That's it? This isn't some dangerous cult gathering?"
No one's any danger here, except in danger of making connections, a hangover, and promising the moon.
I did manage a polite laugh at that. If everyone here was like Richard, then perhaps my dreams of carving out a sliver of the pie for myself would still come true.
"Well, in that case, I did come hoping to make some connections."
"Perfect, then let me be your guide. But first, let's get you something to fit in with the crowd. They'll warm to you more once you look the part."
"What's wrong with my dress?"
"Just doesn't fit in with the aesthetic or culture, you know? Unless you're looking to play the part of Little Red Riding Hood. We do have some wolves here tonight," Richard said with a lilt as he turned, leaving me to follow him.
"Would that make you the big bad wolf?" I said,
in as playful a manner as I could summon.
He turned to walk backwards so he could face me.
Big bad bear, obviously," he said in a tone equally playful to mine.
I followed Richard in comfortable silence to a very rustic-looking yurt away from the main gathering.
"And there are some bins for your belongings, as well as some masks, body paint, and clothes. Pick whatever feels right."
I took my time combing through the piles of clothes and sifting through a bin of masks until a red fox mask jumped out at me. I don't know what it was, but it felt like a part of me the moment I laid my eyes on it. Like something I'd searched for a long time and had just rediscovered. I stared into its empty eye holes and saw my own green eyes there, but they were deeper, wiser, and filled with more life than I'd ever seen in my own reflection. A primal calling in my features that stirred something in my spirit that now awakened was a siren's call to me. With a small bit of trepidation and anticipation, I put it on, and something just clicked in me, like I'd woken up from some waking dream and stepped into my real self.